So that's on behalf of your pastors, Abe. We love you guys.
Very touching.
Thank you, everyone. We
thank
miss you
so
guys
much.
Too.
Miss
oh my
you.
Goodness!
Virtual hug to everybody. Yeah. Virtual hug to everybody. All.
Good morning, and welcome to Central Baptist Church Sunday morning worship service. We're so glad that you chose to worship with us this morning. I want to say hello to all of our family and friends. And if it's your first time worshiping with us, welcome. Welcome to Central Baptist Church. Central, we have a praise report. Sister Pittman called us and said that her son Jonathan is doing much better, that the fever broke, and she thanks you for your prayer. So, thank you so much, Central. We know that when we request prayer for someone, that the church family goes into action praying. So continue to pray for one another and pray for those that are still out there working, the ones that are on the front lines, those that are experiencing illness and financial difficulties. Just continue to pray. We're just praying for one another and praying for our whole entire world and nation that we'll come through this difficult time that we're having right now. Remember, if you have a prayer request, you can call the church office and leave the prayer request on the line, or you can push the prayer request button right there on the screen and we will see your prayer request. If you have any needs, or if you're in need of food or just to talk with someone, that would be another reason to call the church office and let us know so that we can reach out to you. I want to say, anyone that's having a birthday, happy birthday to you today. I want to acknowledge Reverend Dredd, who turned 90 last Sunday. And I also want to acknowledge Mother Mabel, who turned 98. So anyone that has a birthday today, happy birthday. Also, family, I want to remind you that this is Pastor's birthday month. His birthday is on May 18th, so we want to wish our pastor a happy birthday, and something will be coming through email to you in response to celebrating at a distance with Pastor this month. Again, we always thank you for your givings. Central, you've been so faithful with giving, and we just want to let you know the different ways that you can give. You can text CBC Carson to 77977. You can mail your tithes and offerings in. You can drop it off here at the church, or you can give online on our website. So Central, we are just so blessed. Our church family is blessed. We're doing great things. We're moving forward. The Word of God is still going forward. Let me just thank you for tuning in every single Sunday and worshiping with us. God bless you, and we'll see you next week.
And it looked as
if it was all about you. You made a place. And we're standing only because you made a way. Now we're here, not knowing how we'll get through this test, but holding on to faith, you know best, and nothing can catch you by surprise. You've got this figured out, and you're watching us now. When it looks as if we can win, that's when you wrap us in your arms and step in. And everything we need, you supply. You've got this in control, and now we know that you made a way. When our backs were against the wall, and it looked as if it was over, you made a way. And we're standing here only because you made a way.
Yes, you did.
Good morning, everyone. I want to welcome you again to our online worship experience. I truly miss each and every one of you, and I thank you so much for joining us this morning as we go into worshiping and serving the Lord. So it's good to have you with us. So we're going to start off this morning with a word of prayer. We're going to ask the Lord to guide us through this whole message here. So let us bow if you're at home with me right now. Father God, we thank you this morning, O God, for how you've been such a blessing to each and every one of us. We thank you, O God, even during these uncertain times, O God. We know that you're fully in control. We know, O God, that you've been watching over us. So, Father, we ask that you would just continue to touch those that are going through these challenges that they're faced with. So, Father, bless me right now, O God. Fill me with your Holy Spirit that I may bring forth your word in a powerful way. I ask that you would sit me down, that you would stand up in me, stand in these shoes, speak through my mouth, O God. I thank you in advance for what you're going to do, as we ask it all in the name of Jesus, our Lord, our Savior, and our Redeemer. Amen. Amen. So if you have your Bibles, hopefully you do have those, I would like for you to go with me over to Matthew's Gospel, the very last chapter. We're going to go over to Matthew chapter 28, and I'm going to begin reading at verse 16. Matthew chapter 28, verse 16, and the text reads as follows. Then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee, into a mountain where Jesus had appointed them. And when they saw him, they worshiped him. But some doubted, and Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. I want to talk to you today from a title of, let's go make more disciples. Just simply, let's go make more disciples. In these passages of scripture here, we look at these, and here in these verses of scripture, we find that the 11 disciples were on their way to Galilee, the mountain where Jesus had told them he would reunite with them. Then when Jesus arrived, they worshiped him. And the text says here, some doubted and had hesitations of Jesus and so forth. The doubts didn't faze Jesus, though. What Jesus does now is he gives them a charge. He gives them a charge. In other words, Jesus tells them that God authorized and commanded him to commission all of them, and that is for these men to go out and reach and teach and win and bring in more disciples. And Jesus was given his last orders to these disciples before he ascended, to go out and win people to Christ. I like our motto we have here. It's winning people to Christ, loving people in Christ, and building disciples for Christ. And it's similar to the same analogy, the same thing here. And that's our motto here at Central Baptist Church. Our mission statement here at Central Baptist Church. So in other words, Jesus is telling these disciples to keep training people for kingdom building. That's what Jesus is really going to. Now, just like Jesus was telling the disciples to go make more disciples by preaching, teaching, and even baptizing. And so what we see here is we must remember that making disciples is the very reason why Jesus left us here in the first place. That's one of our main purposes being here, is to win more disciples. And this life is mainly about us telling others about our risen Savior, Jesus Christ, and our need for him in our life in order for us to have a never-ending life with Jesus in paradise. So what I want to do in this message here is I want to give you seven practical ways that I believe will help fulfill the Great Commission in your life that I believe will help fulfill the great commission that Jesus commanded all of his disciples and us, which is teaching others about Jesus in this message this morning. And I want you to please understand me here. I'm talking to all of us. All of us are included here. When we're talking about our faith about Jesus and talking to others, it can be a little intimidating to most of us, even the seasoned ones. And it doesn't matter how long you've been doing it, it could still be a bit intimidating. But I just want to give you seven strategies or ways that I believe will make it easier for you to share your faith and believe that know that you're able to teach people. And this is with unbelievers. It could be anyone that don't believe in Christ. But the fact is that we must go and share the gospel or make more disciples. The first practical way is this. We first must know that Jesus saves, not us. We must first know that Jesus saves, not us. We look at Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 3. The Apostle Paul says it this way. He says, "And you hath he quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein time past ye walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our conversation in times past, in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others." So in other words, what Paul is simply telling us, Paul here is describing our former condition, how we were before we came to Christ. And I want to just imagine this. If you were in a cemetery or a graveyard and there's no workers there, you're just in a graveyard, and you were to stand right there in the middle of the cemetery grounds and just simply teach the Bible. And I mean, if you want to say, just say, preach the Bible. Preach it to the best of your ability. Tell the gospel extremely well. And I'm talking about one of the best Bible teachings ever, right in the middle of the cemetery. Do you think anybody dead in that cemetery is going to respond to you? Absolutely not. No. And if they did, you'd probably head for the hills, quick, fast, and in a hurry. So here's the deal here. That's why Paul here was saying, before we come to Jesus Christ, we were dead in our trespasses. We were not able to respond to nothing that was said. We couldn't hear it because we were dead. Dead to our sin, dead in our sin. Nothing spiritually we could respond to. And so, if someone doesn't get saved whenever we first talk to them or witness to them or share the gospel, what happened is we don't blame ourselves. We can't blame ourselves. We do need to think about that and then more so realize that it's not us. Again, it's not us that saves. It's the Holy Spirit. It's Jesus, the one that saves them. But what I want to say here is also, it may be that God has not quickened that person's heart yet. Quickened simply means made that heart alive yet. God hasn't made the heart alive. And their heart is very hardened. It could be that. So the fact is that the heart is hardened towards the things of God. And it's not only when God is able to bring that person's heart to life, but also when they will be able to receive and respond to the things that God has through the Holy Spirit. But whatever you do, we can't give up on sharing the good news. We can't give up on sharing the good news, that is, or going to make more disciples. But I want you to know that no one can save anyone. We can share the gospel and then plant the seed and hope that this is watered, and then also hope that God will give the increase and bring them in. It leads me to my second practical way to win someone to Christ. And that second practical way is this. We must understand the gospel. We must understand the gospel. When we look at 2 Timothy 2:15, Paul again says this to Timothy. He says, "Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." So in other words, we must study God's word to understand what God's word says and what it means, and build our lives on that word, as well as to build the word into our lives. We build ourselves on the word of God, and we've got to build the word of God into ourselves as well. If you think about it, this is quite obvious. There are a lot of Christians today that have left true Christianity for cults. And it's only because they didn't fully understand the word of God. They were led astray. They were led away from the true gospel. And understanding what exactly the gospel means and what exactly Jesus Christ has done for us. And it's because I believe that there is nothing worse that when someone is ready to become a Christian, someone is like, "Hey, here I am. Hey, I want to become a Christian right now. What must I do to become a Christian? Can you help me?" And that person that is telling them about Christ doesn't even know how to walk them through the simple, basic plan of salvation. The simple, basic plan of salvation of what the gospel is. So just in case, there may be someone watching me right now online, scratching your head saying, "Yeah, what is the gospel?" Let me break it down a little bit. Let me explain it. The gospel is the good news. The good news of what? The good news of Jesus Christ and what he done on Calvary. The good news that the gospel is teaching that Jesus Christ, and recognizing that Jesus Christ has done everything there was that I couldn't do in my own strength, that I would never be able to do for myself. Jesus lived a life that was of perfect obedience, and he offered himself as a perfect sacrifice to satisfy the justice and righteousness of God. That's part of the gospel there. Jesus came, died, was buried, and rose from the dead, that if any man believes in him, he will live eternally with Christ forevermore in paradise. And that's part of the gospel, which leads me to my third practical way, that we can make more disciples, or in other words, share the good news of Christ. We need to build a relationship with those we're moving to make as a disciple. Build a relationship with those. Look at 1 Corinthians 3:6. Paul says this, "I have planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase." Let me read that again. It says, "I have planted, Apollos watered, and God gave the increase." In other words, Paul was using this analogy of gardening to better explain this. Paul was saying that he was the one planting the seeds. If you remember, Paul planted churches and planted ministers and preachers and pastors in these churches. While Paul was planting, he was the one planting the seed, the word of God in the gospel, in the people's hearts, which was the message of salvation. Paul also planted the Corinthian church. Again, that was the church he planted. He was also known to be a church planter. Paul was one that was planting. Then when we come to Apollos, Apollos was the one that watered, which was the help that these believers, which growing stronger in their faith walk. Apollos built on the foundation after Paul planted. See, you ever see a foundation going up? You got to first lay the foundation. Then you plant something on it, build the building, and then there are other things that come off of that. So that's what Paul was talking about. Most importantly, God is the one who makes all of us grow through his Holy Spirit. God is the very core of everything that there is, everything. And so when we witness to people, when we share the gospel with people about Jesus Christ, that may or may not be, they may or may not be ready right then, but we've got to give them time. Let the Holy Spirit do the rest. We can't beat them over the head or yank them in or force them. We've got to let the Holy Spirit work inside of a person to bring them in. So Paul says that you just may be the person that used to be that's used to be the planter. We just may be the person used to be the one to plant the seed. Other times, we may just be the person that waters the seeds, which could take a bit of time, as I said earlier. You may have to spend some time with this person. You may have to sit down and give them, get on the phone with them. You may have to sit down. Well, maybe you have to just stay on the phone with our situation right now. But you may have to talk to them a little bit to kind of give them guidance. They need that. You may have to pray with them. You may have to share the gospel with them. You may have to explain some things to get them off those training wheels, to get them going so that they could go out and eventually make more disciples. We have to be there with them to build that relationship so that they can keep going. Because if we leave them to themselves and there's no watering, what happens is they may fall or backslide. That's why it's so vital to build that relationship. One of the ways that we can help them to grow is to listen to them. Listen to them, hear what they're saying, hear what they've been. There may be some pain. There's some life experience. When we listen, if they may have points of pain in their life, then we need to listen for their traumatic stuff that may come out, or also that may have happened in their life. They may have been hurt by a church or something, and they say, I don't trust churches. We may have to be there to kind of guide them back to understand how to get back in line with things. Something that's happened, we've got to be there to hold their hand, to guide them through it and show them that Jesus cares. So that the point is that the more we listen, the more we're able to get an idea of that world that they were living in, their worldview, if you will, where they are coming from. And ultimately, the more we listen, the Holy Spirit is going to open it up. All we're doing is watering and allowing God to do the rest. We're just the vessel to be the conversation piece. And when the time comes to say something to them, then after listening to all the things, now's the time to ask questions. Listen first, remember that. Then ask questions. Learn about their life, not being too nosy all in their business, but genuinely getting to know them better so that you can develop a friendship with that person. You know, over time, which will grow, and it increases the trust, which will allow you to share even more truth and at the right time, which then will lead into sharing the gospel with them. And then, listen to me, when God gets to work on them, it's going to be amazing of things that will happen to them. Moving on to my fourth practical way that we can make more disciples. And that fourth practical way is have an answer to your faith. Have an answer to your faith. So look at 1 Peter 3:15. Peter says this. He said, but sanctify the Lord in your hearts and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. With meekness and fear. So here Peter says, we should always be ready to give a gentle and respectful answer when we're sharing our faith to anyone. Many times people are genuinely interested in learning more about the Christian faith. They're more interested in learning about it. And they have real questions that if they can at some point be clear on these answers to these questions, and you could be clear to answer their questions, that is the time when they very well need your help. See, help them overcome those objections that they may have about the Christian faith. So I want to give you some questions. If you're listening to me out there online, I want to give you some questions. And I believe that these questions that I'm going to give you should be locked. You should be locked and loaded and ready to answer if anybody asks you these questions. And these are basic questions here. And these are questions that a lot of unbelievers especially will ask. Unbelievers are going to ask you this. And here's the question. The question is this. Why does God allow evil in this world? That's a question that may be asked by you, by an unbeliever. Another question is, why is Christ Jesus and Christianity, the only way to get to heaven? That's another question. And I'll have a few more here. The next one is, how can God be three persons in one? Another question is, how can the Bible be written by God? Then another question, doesn't the Bible have errors? You got to answer these questions because people are going to come at you, and we've got to be ready to answer as to our faith. And another question, how do we know that Jesus really existed? We got to answer these questions. The last question is, how do we know that he really rose from the dead? Unbelievers are going to come with you with questions that will boggle your mind, but you've got to be ready, locked and loaded with the word of God to come back at them and share, to help them come in, to help disciple them. This is the way you help them to understand. This is planting the seeds. If you don't know this, they're going to scratch their head and say, I don't know if I want to mess with this. We've got to have answers to these questions. And these are just some of the questions that people are going to ask us when we are sharing our faith or when they have objections to the Christian faith. And it's so vital, so very important that we understand, as Peter just said in these passages of scripture here, which was being ready to give an answer to why we believe in Jesus Christ. They may just ask that one question, why do you believe in Jesus Christ? We've got to be ready, again, as I said, locked and loaded to give an answer. Moving on to my fifth point, a fifth practical way that we can share the gospel or make more disciples, stay away from debating. We don't need to debate. Stay away from debating. Reason why I say that, look at 1 Peter 3:15 and 16. The last part of 15 and 16, I want to get 15. The last part says, with meekness and fear. And then verse 16, it says, having a good conscience, that whereas they speak evil of you as of evildoers, they may be ashamed that falsely accuse your good conversation in Christ. I want you to please listen to me out there. Listen to me very closely on this one here, folks. Please hear me. What Peter is saying here is that we don't have to be noisy, obnoxious, pushy to try to push our faith on them. We don't have to do that. When it comes to sharing our faith with people, because for one thing, when we are sharing our faith with people, some people you meet are going to have a real desire to know what Christianity is really about. However, their goal of these other folks is to trap you. You have folks out there that are doubting, that folks that are ready to trap you in something, and they're not at all interested in learning about Christianity. These kind of people are the type of people that the Holy Spirit should lead you to move in a new direction. Why? It's because of the fact that their hearts are still hardened. These folks want a debate. They want to prove you wrong. They're not looking to try to find out about Christ. They're looking to make you stumble. And these kind of things, these kind of folks, you'll never really get to. No matter how great you might be in expounding on the Word of God, they are all not convincing to that at all. They're not in a position to receive the truth of God. They are more so debating you. There's a hidden agenda, so it's better not to get into a debate. So in other words, Paul again was saying, we should continue to be gentle and respectful when we're sharing our faith with people. Moving on to my sixth practical way to make more disciples, sharing or share the good news. Be ready with your testimony. Be ready with your testimony. Now, a lot of Christians, and this is as far as we get, when it comes to giving our own personal testimonies, some may say, well, I'm just a Christian. I've been a Christian since I was 7 years old. My mama brought me to church, and I've been a Christian ever since that time. I grew up in church. I was brought up in church. Some of the answers we usually give, I did go to Sunday school because my mama, daddy would have whooped my you know what. See, the thing is we can't just say simple, soft messages like that. We can't say those kind of things, but I do know what God has done for me. These are the things we say. I do know what God has done for me. I know God has changed my life, and I'm still learning as a disciple of Jesus Christ today. I don't walk the way I used to walk. I'm walking different, but I tell you what, I'm praying more, I'm trusting more, I'm studying more, and I'm seeing greater things happening in my life. The peace that I have within now and the peace with God is so much greater. These are the answers that we must give. In other words, those three right there, those answers I just gave, those answers are your testimony, which is about your life transformation, is what you give. How God changed you into a new creation in Christ Jesus, as to know why you're a believer in Christ Jesus and know that he is not finished changing you yet. These are the things. Everything we do in life has to be a refining process where God is consistently refining us. And then we have to let them know he'll never be through with me. Even when I become so great as a preacher or whatever it is he has for me, I know there's still work in this life for me. And that's how we have to share the good news or share our testimony. But also know this by itself is not enough. Why? Is because they may reply, that's all good, but I have a friend who is a Muslim, and he follows all their rules and teaching of Islam, and his life changed too. What makes your stuff, your Christianity, better than Muslim? We've got to be ready. And so again, you should be ready to share the good news, ready to make them or share the good news or plant that seed that will convert them into a follower of Jesus Christ. Now, if they don't do it, kick rocks and run. Kick rocks and leave. Find somebody who's willing, has a softer heart to receive. Maybe it takes time for that hardened heart. Who knows? Only God knows that. And listen to me, folks. A testimony of how God has transformed your life is what represents who you are right now. Let me say that again. A testimony of how God has transformed your life represents who you are right now. Moving to my seventh and final practical way to share the good news, and that is this: have faith in God. Have faith in God. Throughout the whole process of sharing the good news, when you are reaching and going to make disciples, is sharing the good news. It should be the start of trusting God. While doing it, you must trust God. You must trust God. You must get in prayer before you even talk to him. And I just want to say this in closing, going to back to my leadoff scripture, Matthew 28, 19 and 20 is the one I want to talk about. In these passages of scripture here, I just want to emphasize on the words here that Jesus said. He says, I am with you always, even until the end of time. Now, Jesus is clearly saying he's with us. Jesus just said it right there in the text, that we should be encouraged as we share the gospel with others, Because when we share the good news, share our faith, when we reach to make more disciples, Jesus is right there with us. And if we pray before that time, Jesus will give us the words that we should say at the right time. We are to Jesus' presence, should I say. Jesus' presence is with us. We are not alone. We're not by ourselves. We must recognize that he lives in us. He guides us. He speaks through us. He teaches us. He speaks to us to bring back to remembrance everything that we've been taught here so that we could voice those things and share them with other folks. Our lives, we should not be nervous. Know that Jesus is with us when we share the good news, when we talk about our life-changing testimonies. And I just want to encourage somebody out there right now to just spend time in prayer as often as you possibly can, because if you have prayer, you have power. No prayer, there is no power. You have to have prayer in your life before you step out and do something. You must ask God, ask Jesus to give you the guidance, give you the words, give you the person, give you everything you need when you do this, to lead you, to speak right through you, to speak to you at the time you need this. And that is the thing we need most, is to hear the Holy Spirit of God speaking to us as we speak to them. We must ask God to fill us with his wisdom, insight, give us the courage, give us the strength of what we need, who we're going to go to, and so forth. So that when we begin to fellowship with this person or begin a fellowship relationship with that person, then the Holy Spirit will be leading us in this fellowship with that person all throughout the time we're with them. That person will be led closer to Christ as we share that good news. And when we think about all this here, Jesus made it so very clear to us here in these passages of scripture. He said, go ye therefore and teach, not some nations, but teach all nations. Jesus didn't say to try to go. It was not an option. It was not a gift. This is not a gift, but this is a commission, the great commission Jesus gave us. He given it to us directly from Jesus. And commission simply means an instruction, a command, a duty, or an order. To go into the world, because we're in a dying world. What if the world ended today? What if the world ended today and there's somebody that we could have shared and brought to Jesus, as he went over the plan of salvation and won that soul? What if they were to go tomorrow and we said, I should have shared the gospel. It was on me, but I didn't do it. We need to share the good news to everybody, because it's the good news. Baptizing new converts in Jesus Christ, in their death, in his death, burial and resurrection. It was Jesus' life, death, burial, and resurrection that made it so possible for us today that we can have him indwelt in us and empowering us to give the word of God. We're not saved to be all by ourselves, to be an island. We're saved to share the good news, to share the good news. It's all because of what Jesus done for us on Calvary. We can't forget about what Jesus done. Jesus' shed blood was for the remission of sins. It was Jesus' life, death, burial, and resurrection. I can't emphasize it enough to share the good news. And I want to say something to you in closing with these last words. If you had a cure for cancer, a cure, you discovered a cure, you have it, you have the remedy, and it's healed you of cancer. Would you keep it to yourself or would you share it with others? The idea is that we have the cure to sin, and that's Jesus Christ. And like the singer said, the songwriter said, he said, I wasn't going to tell nobody, but I couldn't keep it to myself. We need to keep it. We need to share it with other folks. We need to let them know, a dying world, that Jesus Christ is the only way. We need to go and make more disciples. Make more disciples. Amen. I want to invite someone right now that is watching me online. I want to extend the invitation to Jesus Christ. You may have never accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. Well, this is your opportunity right now. This is your opportunity. I know the Bible tells us, John 3:7, it says, where Jesus said to Nicodemus, you must be born again. And God gives us his word, and his word is true. You must be born again. Romans 10:13, Paul says this, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And if you're watching me right now, you can be saved right where you are, right there where you are. It's just a simple prayer. All you have to do is just bow your head. If you want to be saved right now, just simply bow your head with me and just say this simple prayer. Just bow your head with me right now and just say this simple prayer. Say, Lord God, I am a sinner. I am truly sorry. I repent of my sins. Please have mercy on me, Lord, and save me. I believe that Jesus came, died, and rose again for my sins. I ask Jesus to come into my heart right now. I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. If you said that simple prayer right there, you are now saved. You are now in the family of God. If you were to die tomorrow, you have a heavenly home with Christ Jesus. You are with Jesus. There's nothing no one can say. Nothing no one can take it away from you. No one can take that. You can claim salvation by faith right now in Jesus Christ. We're going to continue right now into our communion service right now. This is our first Sunday, so I'm going to give you a few minutes to get your communion together, your emblems, and I want you to just bow with me. We're going to pray over these emblems. So everyone at home right now, let us pray. Father God, we thank you this day, oh God. We thank you for what Jesus done for us on Calvary. Just as the Passover celebrated deliverance from slavery into Egypt, we know the Lord's Supper celebrates deliverance from sin by Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. So by us eating of this bread and drinking of this cup, it shows that we are remembering Christ's death for us. We're renewing our commitment to serve you, O God. So, Father, we ask you right now, as we stand here, confess our sins, we ask that you resolve any differences we may have, remove any barriers that may affect our relationship with Christ Jesus. So we thank you, O God, for what he's done for us on that glorious day. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So if you have your communion, we're going to take the bread first. And the bread, we're going to take that. And this bread represents the body, the broken body of Jesus Christ. The Bible says that Jesus said on that night that he was betrayed the night before, he said, take eat. This do in remembrance of me. As often as you eat this bread, do it in remembrance of me, right after he prayed for it. So we're going to partake of this bread together in remembering what Jesus done for us on that night. After Jesus took the bread, he then took the cup. In the same manner, he said, this represents my blood in the New Testament. And as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, and this cup represents the New Testament in my blood, he said. He said, as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, do it in remembrance of me until I come back. So we're going to partake of this cup together. So let us all drink together. Thank you again for joining us. God bless you. God keep you. And remember, next Sunday, Mother's Day. So we have a special treat for you. So we'd love for you to join us again next Sunday, same time, 10 a.m. So God bless each and every one of you. Thank you again for joining our worship experience. God bless you.